First of all, let me just introduce myself and my interest here. My interest in this topic was as part of a larger interest. That's what all academics will say. This is part of a larger project on the history of Mexico since 1940, the history of Mexico, in particular the history of Mexico in the 1940s that I've been working on. It's also sparked my interest in Walt Disney and Mexico, because the focus of this talk is very much Mexico. Was sparked by the new turn of international and transnational history over the last 10 to 15 years. So there's been a major shift in the way in which international relations specialists, the IR community, and historians who are interested in international relations, there's been a big shift in the way in which they framed their work over the last 10 to 20 years. The main shift is that international studies and international relations and international diplomatic history is no longer seen as a history exclusively of state-to-state relations. That traditionally was the focus certainly of diplomatic history, and I believe it was also a major issue in international relations. So in the last 20 years or so, our attention's been directed a bit away from states, and we haven't neglected states, but we're looking now increasingly at actors, other historical political actors, non-state actors. And in part this is a shift that has to do with what was often referred to as the cultural turn in academic studies, one which has tended to downplay somewhat the traditional focus on patterns of domination and subordination, which is a kind of understandable focus when you're looking at Latin America, and gives greater weight to non-state actors, particularly social movements, intellectuals, cultural and social political actors in civil society and their networks. And that emphasizes the point that international relations involve some degree of negotiation. It's not simply a question of domination by the powerful states, and subordination by the peripheral or subordinate and weaker societies. Now, in the last year, there's also been a rebirth of interest in Disney and Latin America. So my interest began about 4 or 5 years ago. There's always been work done on Disney's Latin American use during the Second World War. But it's not been as extensive as many of us would have liked. But there's been a sudden spurt of interest, a rebirth of interest in Disney and Latin America, seen particularly in two events. One was the production of a new documentary called Walt Disney and El Grupo. And I'll explain what El Grupo, the group, is in a minute. It's a reconstruction in the form of a documentary, so American, a US documentary, of a 3-month tour of South America, and I use the term South America advisedly, made by Walt Disney and a team of artists and writers and musical specialists that was made in 1941. It was between September, so it was made say that the visit to Latin America occurred in 1941. And this documentary has been shown in the United States. I don't think it's been sort of reached Australia yet. It wasn't terribly successful in the United States. It's a very, very rather dull documentary, but it does reconstruct the history of Disney's very first team sent to South America, particularly to Brazil, Uruguay, Argentina, and Chile, with side trips to the Andean countries, including Central America and Mexico. But more important, perhaps, than that is the production of a book. Am I allowed to go from outside of the view here? I'm sorry about this. But an important book came out last year. I just want to refer to it. This is it. Wouldn't we all in the Academy like to produce books with titles and with wonderful graphics and colour like this? But none of us really get a chance to do that, except for Mr. J.B. Kaufman, who is one of the doyens of Disney studies. Believe it or not, there is such a thing. Who's written extensively about the history of cartooning in the United States and has a particular interest in Walt Disney. He's now employed by the Walt Disney Family Foundation, which just opened a kind of museum in San Francisco, which is independent of the Disney company, but nevertheless has a close relationship with the Disney company. which opened last year, and which tells the story of the Disney Corporation. And this book is about 10 years in the making. It's a study, the first study in any language in book form of the history of Disney's relationship with Latin America during the Second World War, which is one part of which I want to talk about now. It adds, say, to what is already a small but growing body of material on the Disney-Latin American relationship. It's by far the most detailed examination of Disney's Latin American films we have, and it's certainly the only treatment that we have in English or any other language which takes advantage of Disney's own archives. Film studios have very good archives. It's a requirement, a bit like medicine. You can't be an effective medic unless you have very good medical records. Or similarly, film companies always have very good archives because they need to store scripts and record script changes over time. But they rarely are made available to independent researchers. Only in recent years, when they passed into the hands of universities, Disney has been particularly jealous. I think that's the right word. Of its collection, and has not allowed independent researchers into its archives ever, until this man comes on the scene. But he has a very close relationship with Disney, which has given him the privilege of digging into the archives of the Disney company. It also, I think, creates some problems, some limitations, because when you're given access to a previously closed archive, normally there's an understanding, an implicit understanding, that you treat the archive very, how can we say, carefully. You don't do your ropa sucia, your dirty washing in public, and so on. Now, I'm going to show you, first of all, some extracts from the film that is the focus of my talk, which is The Three Caballeros, because that's what it's called in the English language versions. Obviously, in Spanish-speaking countries, it's referred to as Los Tres Caballeros, but it's The Three Caballeros. It's one of two Disney films, cartoon films, made during the Second World War. The first one was called Saludos Amigos, which I'm sure doesn't need to be translated for most. It means hi, friends. That was made in 1942, and it was the immediate product of the tour of Latin America that I referred to a few minutes ago, Disney's 1941 tour of Latin America. The film I'm going to be talking about, The Three Caballeros, was made later. It was made in 1943 and 1944. It was released publicly for the first time in December of 1944. And it's the more ambitious of the two documentaries. And you'll see why in a minute. Not documentaries, the most ambitious of these cartoon films, although they do have a documentary character to them. And the focus of my talk is really, what does it mean? What do these documentaries tell us about the history of the relationship between Mexico and the United States during the Second World War? Between Mexico and Hollywood, between Mexico and the US government, which, as you'll see, played a very important role in the backgrounding and finance of these films. And I want to say something about the film themselves. And I want to end up, if I have time, if the chairperson allows me, I want to say something about what these films, and particularly what The Three Caballeros, might tell us about a long-standing debate, a long-standing controversy amongst people who are interested in mass media and how mass media is received. And that's a debate about whether there is something called cultural imperialism or cultural colonialism. In recent years, the literature on Disney, the last 30 or so years, has been a literature that has mostly emphasized Disney as a kind of ideological arm of the US state, or of US capitalism, and has argued that Disney films were pioneers in the development of something that could be called cultural imperialism. So I want to, at the end, say, well, what is the way in which this film was received in Mexico? What does that tell us about whether this term, cultural imperialism, is useful? Is it useful? Is it not so useful? What are the limits of this term? Because nobody really has ever looked at how these films were received in Latin America. There's an assumption that all you need to know is what the ideas were in the heads of the makers. And that will tell you more or less how they were received. But as anybody who works in media studies or reception studies or art history will tell you, that's a terribly old-fashioned way of looking. I mean, people receive and interpret films and plays and music, etc., in ways that are often very unpredictable and often run counter completely to the intentions of the filmmakers. So that's what I want to do at the end. But beforehand, it's impossible to talk about a film or about music or a play or a book without showing you samples. I'm sure you've all had the experience of listening to a paper about a book and you've not read the book and you wonder what on earth people are talking about. So I want to show you bits of this film. It's about 50... I'm not going to show you the whole of it, unfortunately. It is commercially available. You can buy it, you know, sort of from Disney Corporation, whatever, or online. I'm going to show you just some bits of it. It's actually a film that is made up of a series of episodes. The two most important of these episodes are the episodes that deal with Brazil and the episode that deals with Mexico. There are episodes also in Argentina and Uruguay and Chile. But the two big case studies here are Mexico and Brazil. It takes the form of a travelogue. And as you'll see later on, I'm going to be noting the fact that this film in many ways is a film about tourism, although until recently we haven't really kind of fully understood that, although people at the time did understand that very, very well. It's a film which a number of Disney figures appear. Most of them are birds. Okay, you'll see they're classic Disney birds, including Donald Duck. But there are a few characters here who you may not be so familiar with, particularly the Brazilian parrot, who in this film is named José Carioca. Classically kind of Brazilian name. And each of these episodes, we are introduced to a particular figure who takes responsibility for a country. And in the case of Mexico, and we're going to begin here. This is where I have to...
José!
I'm telling you this off just briefly.
Now we're three gay caballeros.
Three gay caballeros. José Carioca. Donald Duck on the right, of course. El Pato Donald, as he's known in Spanish.
We're happy amigos, no matter where he goes, de pronto and fricos, we're always together.
The man, this guy here, on the... I can't find him, but he's moving around so much. But this guy is the Mexican hero. Pancho Pistolas. Pancho of the pistols. Although, in some reason, it's misspelled as Pistoles in the English language version of this film. So it's a musical film. Music plays a very, very important role. And Mexicans amongst you will recognize the origin of this particular song. It's the signature tune of this film, but it is a song which has its own history. It's Spanish. This was a very, very popular song in 1941, 1942, and 1943. Its original title is Ay Jalisco No Te Rajes, which has nothing whatsoever to do with the theme of this film. But it was chosen by Disney for perhaps pretty good reasons. It goes on and on and on. What happens very shortly is that there is a piñata episode where the piñata, which is a papier-mâché, normally an animal or a fruit or something, is hoisted, and from the papier-mâché drop all kinds of toys and presents. All classic Disney devices, of course. And now we have the piñata. I'm going to stop this at this particular moment and move on to another episode. Give you a bit of the flavour of the... Now, the question is, how do I get back to the Mexico episode involves visits on a flying serape, a flying carpet, to Veracruz on the Gulf Coast, to Acapulco, we'll see in a minute, and to Michoacán in west central Mexico. And here you see people dancing what was this time was called Lilonga, but would soon be known as La Bamba. And what you see is one of the things that has always fascinated historians of cartooning, because this was the first time in color that Disney experimented with the combination of live action and cartooning. So here you have Pancho Pistolas. This woman is the sister of Carmen Miranda, Aurora Miranda, who was making a career in Hollywood at this time. This episode, it looks as though it's filmed, might be filmed in Veracruz, but in fact it was filmed on a soundstage in Hollywood. The technology, my emphasis here upon the technology and on technological ingenuity feels very important, I think, because one of the most interesting responses, among the most characteristic responses in Latin America, not only in Mexico and Brazil, but in Argentina and Chile, where the film was shown, and we'll see in a minute why it was shown in these countries, one of the most characteristic responses of the general public and of critical responses was an astonishment and an amazement at the technological achievement and sophistication of Disney. There's nothing quite like this style of animation and live action. Nothing quite conveys the technological superiority and mastery of the United States in filmmaking in the 1940s. Now, I have to stop this unfortunately again. However, enjoyable it would be to someone. The last episode before I go on to actually talk properly to you would be the episode that is set in Acapulco on the Pacific coast. So what we've just seen is what's Veracruz on the Gulf Coast of Mexico. But there's an episode here set in Acapulco, and this is particularly interesting to me because it connects with an interest I have in the history of tourism in Mexico. And I said originally that in many ways this film can be read as a series of travelogues. At a particularly interesting moment in the history of Latin America, particularly of US relations with Mexico and the Caribbean, when you are beginning to see the emergence of modern tourism. It still has to wait for a couple more years until the Second World War is over, and when there's a regularization of air traffic and currency controls begin to be relaxed. But it's in the 1940s that the groundwork is being set out for the development of what is now the most spectacular and certainly by far the largest example of tourism in Latin America. So here's Acapulco. You see here the establishing shot. You've got the boys on their flying serape. This establishing shot. Well, we've missed it now, but what you see before is actually a genuine shot of Acapulco, and now we close into the best-known beach at this time, known as Caleta Beach, which is still there today, although it's no longer the fashionable beach. And what else do you expect to find on beaches? Here's the genuine shot of Caleta. Here we have Las Chulitas Mexicanas, Mexican beauties, and they're driving Donald Duck and Pancho Pistolas and José Carioca absolutely mad. This is an extraordinarily eroticized presentation of the Disney characters, something which did offend some US critics when they appeared. Now, if you're saying they don't look very Mexican to me, the women, then you'll be absolutely correct. Because this film, although it was cleverly designed with a designed, as say, with establishing shots, the opening shots of Carr's feature genuine, come from an earlier documentary. This film, these sequences were actually filmed, we now know, thanks to Jacob Kaufman's work in the iPad, we know they were filmed in the parking lot of the Disney film studios, with secretaries, with Disney secretaries and lots of sand. So these are, in fact, secretaries of, I have no idea what kind of background they come from. So, but some of them might even be of Mexican background. So, but the beautiful bathing beauties are now seen here to be kind of dancing and being pursued by Donald Duck. So this is Donald Duck as he's never been portrayed before, a sexualized Donald Duck who seems to be in a permanent state of sexual excitement throughout the entire sort of episode. Which is an interesting part of the history of this this movie. And here I'm going to, something to put the light back on again, I'm going to move from this to, how do I turn the bloody thing off? That's the key thing. How do I turn this off? Is there a thing for turning it off?
Okay.
Can you sort of somehow do that? Good. So now to the more academic-y bit. Of the presentation. I want to start off first of all by saying something about the history, the antecedents, the origins of the United States film industry's interest in Mexico. This is by no means the first example of a US film made which focuses on Mexico, or for that matter on Latin America. Mexico's always had a special attraction for US filmmakers. It's not entirely surprising, I mean, given Mexico's geographical location with a common border, and given the very close, often collaborative, but also very conflictive relationship between Mexico and the United States. And Richard Slotkin put it very well in his book, Gunfighter Nation, when he said, I'm quoting him here, in the early 1950s, Mexico was the third world country Hollywood knew best, both as a place in which to make movies and as a subject. So I want to say just a little bit about what were the dominant themes shaping Hollywood's representation of Mexico before the 1940s. The traditional themes of US film treatment of Mexico in the period before World War II were one of two frames, one of two concerns. The earliest Hollywood interest in Mexico was an interest in the phenomenon and the way in which Mexicans were portrayed in Hollywood films, certainly before the 1920s, was the presentation of Mexicans as greasers. This is a term of great insult in the United States, not a term I think used much anymore. But greaser, G-R-E-A-S-E-R, clearly I think a reference, we think, to the alleged use of lots of pomade and, I don't know, hair grease and so on by people of Mexican origin in the United States. So morbid, it's linked to a morbid fascination of Hollywood filmmakers with the armed struggles of the early phase of the Mexican Revolution of 1910-1920. It's the most unflattering way in which Hollywood represented Mexico. There in the mid and late 1930s, which is the period closest to the one in which the Disney commitments developed, you get a beginnings of a second way in which Hollywood begins to engage with Mexico. It's a tentative and sometimes ambivalent commitment by Hollywood to some aspects of what was called the good neighbor policy, introduced by the Roosevelt administration, FDR, in the mid and late 1930s, which marked a new phase in the history of United States' relationship with Latin America, and a move away from overt policies of intervention and invasion and occupation to a policy of good neighborhood in which the United States allegedly tolerated and accepted and was prepared to work with its Latin American neighbors to the south. And good examples of this much more inclusive and much more sympathetic good neighborly approach to Mexico. A good example would be the film Juarez, which you occasionally will see, or very often will see on late night television. And I don't have time to talk about that particular film, but it's one which essentially as the Second World War begins to approach, it was made I think in 1938-39, as the Second World War approaches, Hollywood filmmakers begin to deal with Mexican history, and Benito Juarez was a great hero of the 1850s and 1860s in Mexico, president and the leader of the nation in its campaign to expel the French who had occupied Mexico in the early 1860s. There was a brutal civil war which eventually was won by the Mexican patriots. And it's quite clear that this treatment of Juarez, which is a very sympathetic treatment, is simultaneously it's an interesting biopic, you know, the classic Hollywood variety, but it's also a kind of anti-fascist allegory, I think, quite convincingly. I think that's the case. Where there was no Nazis in the film, and this is after all France in the 1860s, but it's quite clear the treatment, the very hostile treatment of France in this film about Mexico was clearly meant to play the French as though they are the representatives of an authoritarian, effete race and nation in Europe. Now, the Second World War, though, was the immediate shaping environment for the film. The Disney films. The good neighbor policy, which I just referred to, deepened during World War II. Remember, the United States takes a while, as my mother always and father always used to tell me, it takes a while to enter the war. It doesn't enter the war until late 1941, after Pearl Harbor. And with the entry of the United States into the war, the good neighbor policy introduced during the 1930s is further extended and deepened into a policy of close collaboration between the United States and its Latin American allies for all kinds of reasons, strategic and economic. Mexico entered the Second World War in early 1942, so it took a while to make that decision. It was a controversial decision for Mexico for all kinds of reasons. Mexico did eventually enter the Second World War on the Allied side and did in fact contribute soldiers and aircraft, one of the only two countries in Latin America to do that, the other being Brazil. The Second World War saw a tremendous deepening of the relationship, the economic and political and social relationship between Mexico and the United States. There were much closer economic, political, strategic and defense links which helped consolidate this relationship, partly because Mexico became a crucially important strategic supplier of raw materials for the US war economy, especially minerals, mercury, zinc, and copper. And this news of Mexico becomes important, even more important economically for the United States. Also, this period of the 1940s coincides with an important shift turn in the direction of what we call the Mexican Revolution, which began in 1910. There's a more conservative consolidation of the Mexican Revolution in the 1940s under the two presidents who rule Mexico in this period, Manuel Ávila Camacho, who was president of Mexico from 1940 to 1946, and then his Minister of the Interior became president of Mexico in 1946 to 1952. His name was Miguel Alemán. So this more conservative shift in the character of the Mexican political process facilitates, I think, the deepened relationship with the United States, because the United States relations with Mexico earlier had been interrupted, altered by the economic and political nationalism of the Mexican Revolution, particularly seen in the 1930s when Mexico was so bold as to actually nationalize British, Dutch and US oil companies in 1938, precipitating a very major crisis in relations between Mexico and the US and Europe. This new this talk is centered around the Second World War, 1941-46, World War II. I do want to point out that the Hollywood interest in Mexico begins in this period, but it really comes to fruition in the second half of the 1940s. With a whole slew of US movies which use Mexico either as the focus or as the place for location, including John Ford's film The Fugitive, the much better known film by John Huston, The Treasure of the Sierra Madre, a wonderful movie, we've not seen it, which is filmed entirely in Mexico. It seems that it's the second post-Second World War period that sees the very first consistent effort by US filmmakers to start location filming outside of the United States. Location filming was known before the Second World War, but it wasn't used on a consistent basis. But after the Second World War, location filming in Mexico becomes important. And the sections of Orson Welles' 1947 film Lady from Shanghai are also filmed in Acapulco. And perhaps less well known and not perhaps taken quite as seriously as these other movies, we have an early Tarzan movie, Tarzan and the Mermaids, which was made in Acapulco, starring Johnny Weissmuller, the very last, the current Tarzan, and which is the beginnings of Johnny Weissmuller's love affair with Acapulco, which is an important part of the history of that city. So there's no doubt that Hollywood's love affair with Mexico during World War II and the contacts built with Mexicans and Mexican institutions as a result made this continuing fascination with Mexico possible. Back to the Second World War and back to the history of the background of the making of the Three Caballeros and earlier Saludos Amigos. The key element in this on the part of the United States, apart from Disney himself and the Disney studios, was the establishment of a very important new institution within the Roosevelt government during the Second World War. It was called the Office of the Coordinator of Inter-American Affairs. The Office of the Coordinator of Inter-American Affairs, OCIAA, under Nelson Rockefeller, one of the sons of the Rockefeller clan. This was a crucial development, and the OCIAA became an indispensable player in the Disney story. Nelson Rockefeller himself, he was a young guy, I think he was in his early mid-30s at this point, had developed strong interest in Latin America, including Mexico, for well over 10 years before he took up the position of head of the Office of Coordinator of Inter-American Affairs, which I'll describe in a minute. Part of his involvement with Mexico was tied up with his links to the modern art world. He was an art pioneer. He was an early collector of Latin American primitive art, and he was also an early US supporter and patron of Mexican mural painters, of the muralists like Diego Rivera and David Siqueiros. Most famously, he commissioned Diego Rivera, one of Mexico's best known muralists and also a man of the left, had been a member of the Communist Party until 1929 and would return to the Communist Party in the late 40s, but at this period was a Trotskyist. He commissioned Diego Rivera to come to New York to paint a series of murals in the new spectacular Rockefeller Center in Madison Square Garden. So some of you will have been to Madison Square Gardens to see the Rockettes, maybe, and all the other things that you go and see in New York. You won't see, unfortunately, the Rivera murals there, because when the Rockefeller family discovered that there was a portrait of Lenin included in the murals, they were ordered to be destroyed. And later on, by the way, Rivera, when he returned to Mexico, reconstructed these murals in the Palace of Fine Arts in Mexico City, the Palacio de Bellas Artes, where they still are today. Very interesting collections. Now, Rockefeller was also elected to the board of the Museum of Modern Art in 1932. Later in 1930, he developed strong business links with Venezuela, where he helped found the very first modern hotel in Venezuela. And the Rockefellers also developed important film interests in the 1930s, buying particularly RKO Studios. RKO, one of the seven majors, as they were called, film producers. And it's quite significant that it was RKO because, in fact, Disney films were distributed in the 1940s and 1950s through RKO. So this is an early connection between Rockefeller and Disney. Now, what were the aims of the Office of Coordinator of Inter-American Affairs? It sort of sounds like a strange title. It was an organization independent of the U.S. State Department, the principal focus of foreign policy in the U.S., the equivalent of our Department of External Affairs, what used to be called Department of External Affairs, what's it called now? Department of DFAT, Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade, was the State Department. But OCIAA was an organization established independently of the State Department, and was therefore independent of the network of US embassies and consulates all over Latin America, something that was to create enormous tensions between Rockefeller and his OCIAA and US ambassadors who didn't like the idea that there was an organization in Washington which had the ear of Roosevelt and had responsibility for relations with Latin America, but which wasn't going through embassies. I'm looking here very closely at diplomats to sort of see whether they're responding in any way, because obviously it's not convenient for diplomats to find that somehow their role is being bypassed by other organisations. And the poor US ambassador in Mexico City during the Second World War was a man with the unfortunate, for the period, name of George Messerschmidt. Which he never quite, no relation with the sort of Messerschmidt. It was spelled very different. And the diplomatic records are full of angry protests by George Messerschmidt, saying, "I'm the ambassador here and I don't even know what's happening in all these important areas of economic and cultural policy." The OCIA had a number of divisions. Several were concerned with what we would now call cultural or soft diplomacy. And in this category, there was, most importantly for this talk, a motion picture division under another extremely wealthy man. You have to be wealthy in this kind of an industry. It was headed, the motion picture division of OCIA was headed by John, who was known amongst his friends as Jock Hay Whitney, a wealthy Easterner like Rockefeller himself, a Yalee, in other words, he was a Yale graduate, vice president also of the Museum of Modern Art, which is a major vanguard cultural institution in the United States, very important for the history of the artistic and cultural relationship between the United States and Latin America, and which we need to know much more about. Jock Hay Whitney was also a co-producer of Gone with the Wind, the greatest box office success of the 1930s. So these guys like to dabble in filmmaking, and he was also an investor in movie technology and a movie fan. I think he was one of the pioneers or the pioneer investors in Technicolor. He was also very wealthy, which was helped here. What were these organizations doing? What was the function of the motion picture division? Well, one of the main concerns of the motion picture division of OCIAA was the supervision and guidance of US movies on Latin American topics during the Second World War. This is a controversial issue because the US State Department was very anxious that some Hollywood treatments of Latin America, in fact, to be fair, all treatments by Hollywood of Latin America were either insulting, inaccurate, folkloric, etc., etc. So they appointed, sort of, they gave the motion picture division the right to somehow persuade Hollywood major studios to alter scenes that they considered to be unflattering to Latin American societies. The first example of this being done successfully was the very first film made by Carmen Miranda in 1940. So it actually precedes the creation of OCIA. It was called Down Argentine Way. Not a film I think you would need to spend too much time in unpacking and deconstructing. It was regarded as a controversial film because Carmen Miranda, of course, is not Argentinian. She's Brazilian. Actually, she's not Brazilian, she's Portuguese. But nevertheless, she's nationalized Brazilian subject. And one of the most controversial features for the OCIA and the Motion Picture Division was the tendency in Hollywood, which unfortunately has been maintained until today, to homogenize Latin America, to create kind of composite figures, people who are maybe Mexicans but they're playing Cubans, or Cubans who are playing Bolivians, or Chileans who are playing Paraguay. This is no attention paid to accent or to the origins of the actor. Preparation and sponsorship of US film propaganda, evaluation at the local level in Latin American cities, OCIA was very interested in monitoring how Latin American audiences were responding to films, both commercial films on Hollywood, but also documentaries and propaganda movies, which were produced in huge numbers during the Second World War. In fact, the history, modern history of market research in film goes back to the work of the OCIAA, which had panels in each major city in Latin America, in which of local citizens whose job it was to report on how they were responding to films as they were screened in their cities. OCIA also had a very important economic role. It provided technical assistance to the Mexican and Latin American film industry, particularly the modernization of film studios and the provision of new technology, and especially one very crucial thing, the supply of raw film stock, the supply of the raw film necessary to making movies. In those days, there were only three producers of raw film. One was Germany, one was Belgium with Gewehrt, and the other was the United States. Second World War is on, German film stock's not available, Germans obviously wouldn't sell it anyway, Belgium is occupied by Nazi Germany. The United States becomes the sole supplier of raw film in Latin America, which gives the United States and the State Department and all those bodies who are concerned with managing economic relationships enormous monopoly power. And it was used by the State Department, OCA, to reward friends. And Mexico was a friend because Mexico joined the Allies in 1942, and to punish those people who were regarded as enemies. And the enemy at this period, as far as the US State Department was concerned, and it was also the main rival, along with Mexico, of the United States filmically, was Argentina, which was ruled by a military regime at this period, which, according to the US, was suspiciously close to the Axis powers, to Germany and to fascist Italy. So what happens during the Second World War is that the Argentinian film industry, which is one of the top, along with Mexico, one of the two top film industries in Latin America, is starved of film. They can't get film very easily, certainly not from US stocks. They're forced to obtain film from Germany, which is awkward at the time, because it only went further to, I suppose, accelerated US prejudices and feelings about Argentina. And Argentine film studios do not receive the aid which Mexican film studios receive from Hollywood. I haven't got time to talk about this, but basically the whole of the Mexican film industry is renewed during the Second World War. And whole new studios are built at Churubusco in the southern part of Mexico City, and they upgraded with the latest of, well, almost the latest of the latest equipment. So the US used access to film stock to cement its foreign policy relationships and preferences. And the OCIA's activities were a prime example of soft diplomacy par excellence. The film producer Walter Wanger, for example, described US movie exports in a 1950 article, which he called Donald Duck and Diplomacy. He described it as a Marshall Plan for ideas, a veritable celluloid Athens that meant that the state needed Hollywood more than the H-bomb. So that was a slightly exaggerated sort of position at the time, but it indicates how at least Hollywood was seeing this. Now, the US cinematic gaze was also influenced on Mexico, was also influenced by other considerations. One was the promotion of tourism to Latin America. The impact of World War II diverted US tourism away from Europe, for obvious reasons. You couldn't get to Europe, for the most part, towards the domestic arena. So it's domestic US tourism that principally benefited from the Second World War. And to a certain degree, it also directed tourist attention away from Europe to Mexico, which was a close neighbour, and it was also partly known to a small group of adventurous tourists, because there was tourism, foreign tourism in Mexico before the 1940s, but it was a very, very small scale, perhaps no more than about 40 or 50,000 by the late 1930s. And Mexico had a number of other advantages. It had no rationing during the Second World War. The United States actually had rationing, like Australia did, though it was a very generous kind of rationing compared to what happened in Europe. And it also had an enviable repertoire of cultural, archaeological, and other sites embedded within an exotic, folkloric ambiente. The US state interest in tourism was also growing from the late 1930s. There were huge projects like the construction of the immense Pan-American Highway, which began in the early 1920s, linking the southern United States through Mexico, and would eventually make their way down throughout the rest of South America. These were seen as promoting hemispheric loyalties. On the Mexican side, too, interest had grown steadily from the early 1930s in tourism. Tourism was seen increasingly by Mexican governments, as governments everywhere, as a foreign exchange earner. It was a powerful source of foreign exchange. And it was also the builder of bridges, in theory, with foreign publics. And in the Second World War, US cinema travel documentaries, which are a very interesting market of interest and direction of film, there were always, at this period, and I think they were still there until the 1950s and 1960s, for those of you who were around, probably not many of you, there was always a short travelogue in the movies, right? There's always a film about some interesting part of the world, at least there were in Britain and Australia. And there were similar ones made in Mexico. The most known of these were called Travel Talk featurettes. They were produced by a man called James Fitzpatrick, who traveled around all over the world in the 1930s, making these short 15-minute presentations to titillate American audiences. He couldn't make them for Europe during the Second World War, so increasingly he made them on Mexico and Latin America. Now, the what was the interest of the OCIAA in sponsoring the cartoon features by Walt Disney? Because that's what happened. These features could not have been, well, we're going to really rush, could not have been made if it wasn't for the OCIA's financial interest. I believe that the OCIA's interest, AA's interest in Disney and these films couldn't have come at a better time for Disney. Disney in 1941, 42 was going through a major economic crisis. It invested huge amounts of money in a very expensive failure, Fantasia, and the earlier, more commercial film, Pinocchio, had also lost a great deal of money, so it was semi-bankrupt. And also there had been a major and very brutal and very savage strike in 1941, affecting the Disney studios, which paralyzed production. So the invitation from the State Department through the OCIA to make a series of films about Latin America with State Department money came at a very useful and important conjuncture for Disney. It was a blessing that offered Disney a substantial pot of money. And this is the background for the first lead of Walt Disney and his group's tour of South America, which began, I mentioned this earlier, in August 1941, which toured Brazil, Uruguay, and Argentina, while some of its members also visited Chile, the Andean countries, as well as Guatemala and Mexico. A large part of the cost, the infrastructure cost of the tour, were covered by the State Department and by, interestingly, Pan American Airways. And the material collected on this tour of 1941 amounted to literally tons of sketches, drawings, paintings, musical recordings, travel literature, and general writing on local cultural conditions. And seeing the Disney team at work in Buenos Aires, in Montevideo, in Rio de Janeiro, the documentary includes that work, it's very difficult not to see these this expedition as being a kind of 20th century version of the grand ethnographic expeditions launched 60 to 100 years ago, in which anthropologists and ethnographers of the European metropolis would travel around the Third World, capturing, classifying, and ordering elaborate data on that world. The booty, and I'm using this term deliberately, brought back to the US after this tour of 1941 would eventually make its way into Saludos Amigos and eventually into the film Three Caballeros. Now I'm going to have to really sort of speed up here. Let me just say that the film itself is clearly, in my view, a travelogue. I mean, it's in the form of a flying serape, traveling to areas of Mexico which were carefully chosen because of their historic and mostly their tourism influence. Film was, I've discovered, was made with the close cooperation of the new Department of Tourism in Mexico City, which provided all kinds of facilities for the Disney team to make the film. The U.S. Embassy, by the way, in Mexico City during the First World War, was so large, it had over 1,000 people. I think at no time in the history of the relations between Mexico and the United States has the embassy reached that size. That gives us some sense of the scale and the depth of the links between Mexico and the US. That it was possible for the US Embassy and OCIA to have very intimate links with the production of the film. Mexican Minister of the Interior, Miguel Alemán, played also a very important role in the support for this film, partly because he was Minister of the Interior, therefore he controlled things like permits. In all in Mexico and many other countries, you can't make films if you're foreigners unless you have permit from a section of the Ministry of the Interior, because that was the situation back in the 1940s. But it's quite possible that Miguel Alemán also's interest in film, he himself appeared in a cameo role in a movie when he was president in 1947, that his interest in film was not perhaps just limited to this, but it's quite possible that his interest in film was also connected with his interest in film stars, particularly the female ones, because he, for which he and his sons were extraordinarily famous. I only have time in 1 or 2 minutes, although I think we kind of started a little bit late, so maybe I could be given maybe an extra 5 minutes. So I do want to say something about the reception of these films. I said at the beginning that one of the problems facing us when we look at these films, given what we know about these films as statements about the relationship between a very powerful nation, the hegemon in Latin America, the United States, and countries which are strategically, economically, politically rather weaker, there's a temptation to see the films as arms, ideological arms, in a way, of the state cultural apparatus of the United States. Now, there's some truth here, I think. I think it's very, very important when we're looking at cultural relations. It's very important that we don't throw out the baby with the bathwater. It does matter that there are asymmetrical power relationships involved here. The fact that the US has the resources, Mexico doesn't, that we're dealing with a very large country and a rather smaller country, does actually shape outcomes. But at the same time, I think it would be very, very unfortunate if we were to argue that the way in which these films were received in Latin America, and they were designed to be filmed, to be seen in Latin America as well as shown in the United States. They were part and parcel of the cultural diplomacy of the United States. It would be wrong for us to assume that the way in which audiences responded to the film simply echoed the intentions of Nelson Rockefeller and Walt Disney. We know what Walt Disney and Nelson Rockefeller thought because we have their information down in documents, elaborate documents talking about that. But what did people in Mexico City or in San Luis Potosí or Guadalajara or Monterrey or any other city where the film was shown, what did they think about this film? Given the fact that even we now, from the perspective of 2010, are struck, of course, by the problems with this representation, especially the folkloric style, what we would now call the essentialist, oversimplified interpretation of identity that appears in these films. The film, The Three Caballeros, was actually premiered in Mexico City. I think it's the very first time the Hollywood film was ever premiered outside of, well, the second time actually, because Saludos Amigos was premiered in Brazil, in Rio de Janeiro, 2 years beforehand. This is the second time that a Hollywood movie was premiered outside. It was premiered in a spectacular ceremony attended by the president of Mexico, Manuel Avila Camacho, by members of his family and the Minister of the Interior, and made pleasant by the presence of a very important American orchestra, dance orchestra, that was playing in nightclubs in Mexico City at the same time. So how would we get some sense of what people thought about this movie? It's not easy. We know that the OCIA had panels, audience panels. I'm analysing some of the results of one of these panels for Mexico City. The trouble with these panels, though, is that they were chosen by the OCIA, presumably to deliver the kind of story and result that the OCIA wanted. This is not a particularly new or even American phenomenon. No, bureaucratic institutions generally want to hear the story that they want to hear. It will tell us something. Newspapers are the conventional way in which we, from this distance, since there are very few people around, or maybe older people who are very, very young in this period of our life, but most people are dead, newspapers are one way of looking at this. It is possible to see the newspaper accounts, and I've been doing that recently. The trouble with newspaper accounts, though, is that in the 1940s, people who read newspapers, the sociology of that audience was quite different from what it is now. These were newspapers were expensive. There was a less literate population than we have now. So newspapers tended to be read by the middle class and even fairly well-off segments of the middle class. We also know, so it's a skewed representation of the public, we also know from both US and British diplomatic records that all governments, not just the United States and Britain, but also Germany as well, were busy involved during the Second World War in developing close relations with the mass media. In other words, they were basically paying subsidies to local newspapers to publish the kind of news that supported them. And so this also complicates the way in which we use newspaper material, because if the papers are receiving subsidies from the British and US embassies, which we know they were, that may very well have influenced the treatment. What is striking so far for me is the overall very positive way in which these movies were seen, both by the journalists and also from letters to the press, which may be perhaps a slightly more authentic way in which you can sense opinion. Even more interestingly, there appears not to be much difference between what we could call centrist or right-wing views and left-wing views of Disney. Which is interesting because in the last 30 or 40 years, left-wing, the socialist Marxist tradition, has been very hostile to Disney and has seen it's like Disney as a kind of arm of cultural imperialism, blah, 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 blah. But if you look at the left-wing newspapers and columnists of the period, and there were plenty, you'll see that actually they admire this film. Why? Because in part we're talking about the Second World War, it's the anti-fascist struggle, national unity during the Second World War. So these films are meant to promote national unity, therefore that was a great slogan of the left too. Secondly, because these films illustrated more than any other kind of medium, the influence of science and technology. What science and technology, sophisticated science and technology, can do in the media. And this was a really powerful line and point for most people on the left. There was a long-standing left-wing tradition going back to the 1920s of privileging and rewarding and praising the promotion of seeing science and technology as harbingers of a new modernity. The admiration, for example, which is very widespread for the Soviet Union in the 1930s and 1940s, extended way beyond people who were Marxists or communists. Old people were fascinated and identified with the Soviet Union, allegedly because it was an example of a totally planned state using technology to overcome superstition, and that was tractors, socialism equals tractors and electricity, to use a slogan of the period. So in this sense, the use of technology, the mastery of technology shown in this film, while to our gaze, this is slightly problematic, because in a way it's almost a kind of boastful use of the superiority of US technology in the filmmaking industry was actually seen at this period as rather positive. There were one or two exceptions, and I'll finish here. There were one or two exceptions, and of course looking for exceptions is something which you want to do always, because you want to, you know, it's always boring to try and present a sort of unified view, unified reception, which you sort of half suspect is false. There were a few critics who were aware, I think, and responded very badly to the folkloric representation, the gendered, folkloric, essentialist, although this terminology was not used at that period, although folkloric certainly was, representation of Latin America as a country of fiestas and dances and strange artisan products, handicrafts, which of course you could always bring back from your holiday, which is, I think, an important part of the style of these movies. And the most interesting figure in Mexico who represented, let's say, the opinion, the sort of dissenting opinion, was one of Mexico's cultural critics of this period of the 1920s, but especially the 30s, 40s, 50s, 60s. He was a long-lived person and a very interesting man, Salvador Novo. N-O-V-O, a very important figure in the cultural, literary history of Mexico. Also very interesting because he was one of the very first openly gay writers at a time when being gay was something you certainly didn't discuss in public. And Salvador Novo, if you look at Salvador Novo's responses to the film, you'll see that, in fact, he had a rather more nuanced response to the film. And let me just read you, this is the very last thing I say, what he said. He said, "The genius of the creator of Donald," hold on, I've got my papers out of sync here, so I think I've got the right quotation. "The genius of the creator of Donald," remember Donald Duck is the star here, he's a representative of the United States, with all these other birds, these foreign birds. "The genius of the creator of Donald is revealed in the details, in the fact that it's the duck who, as they say in the trade, steals the picture and becomes its true protagonist." So here's Novo kind of spotting very, very quickly that the star of this movie, although it's allegedly a movie which is inclusive and embraces the bird-like representatives of Latin American countries, that the real star, absolutely, of this movie is Donald Duck, the gringo, who, as they stay in the straight, steals the picture and becomes its true protagonist, not once abdicating that role, even in those sequences where the bewitching Bahia, earlier sequence deals with the northeast of Brazil, or the riotous noises of Mexico might have pushed him to the side, minimizing his importance. And this is the most interesting phrase, minimizing Donald Duck's all-conquering involvements. Su intervención vencedora is the original Spanish, which is not easy to translate, but I think my translation there is correct. So here's Salvador Novo noticing that Donald Duck, although he's represented as a stupid bird, which is his conventional role, and he's always misunderstanding things, which is also brought over in the film, that at the same time, he is the kind of all-powerful, all-conquering figure of the film. So I'm going to end there and simply say that what might on the surface be just another entertainment, I can assure people who are parents here that you can spend, you can save hundreds of thousands of dollars by buying a copy of this, these movies and showing them to your kids instead of using babysitters. But it's in spite of the fact that this is a movie which often is treated rather as just a curious episode in the history of the Disney company, it actually is a point of departure. It's an opportunity for reflecting on much broader questions relating to the history of the cultural, social, economic relationship between Mexico and the United States. And it also is an invitation for us to reflect on the issue of reception, of how, in fact, reception over borders and boundaries is not predictable. It's something which is, by definition, fundamentally unstable.
Wonderful. Thank you so very much.